God, we thank you so much, Jesus. We praise you. We worship you. We're so grateful that we're able to come before you, God. Lord, we ask you to have your way in us this morning. Do your work in us, God. We invite you, Jesus. Have your way, God. Amen.
Thank you so much for today, God. Thank you for the great work you're doing, Lord, praying for just an awesome time with the children's ministry that is in Winnsboro today receiving training. God, that their eyes are just being opened to be the most radical, engaging youth ministry that this earth literally has ever seen, and capturing people's hearts that they understand Jesus from a young age in a way they carry him throughout the rest of their years and experience the blessing of that, God. But also, Lord, pray for right here to saying thank you for every person that's here, whether it's the first time, whether it's the 50th time or beyond, God. Lord, that today be a day of just high, highly engaging with you, that we hear the Holy Spirit speaking to us. And Lord Jesus, that our hearts be tender to respond to where you're leading us, Jesus. Because everything you lead is for our good, but also mainly for your glory, Jesus. And God, we just trust, have your way completely. Lead us from here on out. And may we honor you with our time together in Jesus' name. If you're glad to be in church, say amen.
Are high
things new. When you come, you resurrect all the things that once were dead. And when you speak, it's a tidal wave. I never recover from this mighty wake. Before we go forward with this, I just want to encourage you with something. Whatever man has declared over your life or over someone you love, their life, or the report that you may have received, that is not the final word in your life. Jesus has the final word in your life, and he comes to make all things new. And so it doesn't really matter what other people may see in your circumstance, or what other people have declared over your circumstance or over someone that you love, their circumstance. What matters is what God has said over your circumstance. And he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or imagine. So I want you to sing this part with me and just let faith rise up in you. When he comes to make all things new. And it doesn't really matter what anybody else has to say about it. Are we going to believe what God has to say or how we feel or what we see? So I know there's things that I'm standing on for those that I love and for even my own life. And when I sing this line, I just let it resonate down in my spirit. I will not take anything less than what God said, period. I don't care what anybody else sees. I know what God said. So sing that with me. When you come, you resurrect.
When you come, you resurrect all the things that once were dead. And when you speak, it's a tidal wave. I never recover from its mighty wake. When you come, you resurrect all the things that once were dead. And when you speak, it's a tidal wave. I never recover from its mighty wave. Let your freedom reign.
On the solid rock and establish my goings. And he can do that same thing for every person that you're believing him to do that in.
Big hand today, church. Amen, amen, amen. Isn't it great that new life. How many of you are thankful that Jesus found you right where he did and is bringing you to right where you are, but is not to leave you where you are? It is a continual growing journey. It is a constant redemption, constant rescue. So if you will, Jeremiah 1:5, let me share with you this verse real quick. It says, I knew you before I formed you in your mother's womb. I want to challenge you as we go forth today, really just believing in a very big day. I want to challenge you a little bit, and it was ironic how Callie brought up without any plan whatsoever, but the things where there's been hope that's lost, where it's been given up, where there's a protective wall of like, I'm not allowing my heart to go back there. I want to challenge you today to just kind of engage with me, and I want to challenge you today to believe again, honestly. And I want to challenge you today that, you know what, as a result of today, to believe again, to pray audacious, radical, nutso prayers. Even, I tell you what, as a congregation, could we just right now and just in agreement saying, Lord Jesus, today, may I believe again as you believe. And may I see miracles happen in my life to reveal you to others. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen, amen, amen. I knew you before I formed you in the mother's womb. You could summarize all that and say, you know what? God is never surprised. I mean, he is beginning and end, Alpha, Omega. He initiates and he completes. He does not get hung up in the middle. But today we are finishing a series. This is right where we started and not where we're going to stay. But we're finishing the final week in a series called The Big Stories. And we began right here in Jeremiah 1:5 with seeing that before anyone knew you, God knew you. Before anyone else even thought of you, God knew you. And before anybody thought of your mama and your daddy, God knew you. And before your grandparents knew they would have grandchildren, before your grandparents knew they would have children who would have children who would have children, God knew you. I think that's so cool because it's not just like he knows me in the womb. He knew me before any connection happened. Before there was even a desire of two humans, we were a plan of God. Before we were thought of, God planned for you to be born in a time era that you were for his plans through you today. I don't know about you, but I'm continually thankful of that. I'm so thankful I did not have to run around with a gun with a sword on the end of it, you know, dodging behind logs. And I'm so glad for so many just honestly easy things I have been born into that sometimes we take for granted. But everybody is born in a time for the time that God has for them to make the impact that he has designed you for in that time. Before we were thought of by anyone else, God already knew about it. And while this is all information, can we just go here? While this is all information that we can either debate or we can just take the easy route and nod our head and say, yeah, that's right, yeah, that's God. I would venture to say it's probably one of the greatest struggles any person has, that God knew me before anyone else knew me. And he had a plan for me before anyone else ever even considered the idea of me. The reality is, isn't it true that it is one thing to be good little go-with-the-flow people that say, yes, God is bigger than us, and God has a plan for me, and God loves me, and I know, and you've probably said some of these things, I know God is with me. You know, you're going through, and that's kind of the scapegoat. Well, I know God is with me. Or whatever our other little statement that we may generally go with that. And so often we can speak or agree with our head, but sometimes it's a whole different animal to bring our heart to believe it, isn't it? You ever struggle? You ever do that? You ever say things that are just audacious? Yes, I believe that, and I believe God is bigger, and he's all-knowing. But really, when something happens spontaneously that was not planned for, that kind of feels like pinching in the corner, it's like, but my heart struggles to believe what I say I believe sometimes in my head. Do you ever land there? I'll explain. The whole it's a whole new story when it comes to accepting statements at the heart level, isn't it? I'll explain. Have you ever wondered, why do I have to experience this? Why did God let this happen to me? Or have you wondered, when will it ever get better? When will this be over? Have you ever had those seasons? Or maybe have we ever progressed to the place, have you ever entered in that place, is these thoughts, they create a comparison, you know, where we begin to compare ourselves. You know, like, we see others with what we want and wonder why they have it and we don't. Oh, God, why not me? Especially it gets confusing whenever it's people that's like, God, I hear them just like curse you and they don't care. And everything just looks so easy for them. But over here, I am going through, well, God, why? And we get in that comparison trap. You ever been in the comparison world? All of testimonies through time, it seems the greatest struggle of man's understanding of God and the greatest struggle of even his love for us is this. We act as though the temporary moments are the final answer. You ever get there? Everything feels like it is the end, when in reality, we've been through so many temporary moments, if we're honest, that seem like the end, that weren't the end. Have you been through temporary moments that seem like it was the end, but you're still here today? But here's the flip. We can so easily get tripped up in as though our temporary moments are the final moments. But God's designs, he uses the temporary to fulfill the final plan. Isn't that a great idea the devil has? No, I will take them, I will confuse them, and I will tempt them to believe that God's plan is actually God's failure of the plan because the part they're in now is making their life over. And I will keep them away from the idea of ever realizing and remembering that God who began it is a God who will complete it. And he is faithful all the way to the finish. The one who began a good work is faithful to complete the good work, according to Philippians. And I will keep them away from realizing that God is using even this moment, every single temporary moment, it is all in order to fulfill a final plan in our time span on earth, and ultimately to leave a time span that affects even beyond our lifetime. Isn't that the struggle so often? Where were you the last time you heard the news that seemed to knock the feet out from under you? You remember? Maybe you got the phone call and just, I was standing outside of church before everything got going, and I saw two people respond in such a way as if it was that phone call. I saw two ladies, their eyes went this big, their jaws dropped about this far apart, and they went in full sprint, and I couldn't see around the corner what they were seeing. And I was like, oh no, and I took off and I run, and you know, it was a little child that fell from the swing, I think, or something, which is tragic, but it wasn't the end, and it wasn't a tragedy. I see the child very happy right now. But it seems in the moment. Let me just take you down a little story down memory lane. At the mature age of 11 or 12, I was such a mature 11 and 12-year-old when I was as immature as all the rest of them, but thought I was so mature. At the mature age of 11 or 12, though, I arrived at the pinnacle of what I had longed for my entire life, for as long as I could remember anyway. And I remember I'd worked so hard to get to this place, and it come. There was this big meeting, everybody gathered together, and I was finally going to get to recognize for what I had worked hard for. I had believed I was worthy of receiving this award. And as they called the names for every trophy that come along, and they called the names for everybody that come up, this was before the just everybody's an MVP. This is like when there really was an MVP, you know? And so some of us were losers and some were winners kind of thing, you know? We don't have that anymore, I realize. But so they go on through, and I remember they called the MVP. I'm cool with that. You keep that MVP. They called the, I don't know, maybe the next in line MVP. They come up with two or three different awards. You go ahead and keep that. You got that one. I'm not worried about that. You get your little participation trophy. That's fine. I understand that. But then came the moment that I've been waiting for. I've been waiting for like 2 months for this. And I've been waiting for years to arrive at this moment that I was about to hear my name in the line that I wanted to hear my name. I was just in the other places to get to this place. And they said, the names of the people for the Concordia Parish Dixie Youth All-Stars this year are... And they go down the list, and they go down the list, and they go down the list. And I'm like, man, I know how good I did this year. You ever been there? My moment has arrived. I finally arrived at greatness. And my name never was called. And the maturity rose up, and I handled it, and I said, that's okay, Lord. No, I didn't. I squalled, and I cried, and I ran off the field. Because I thought I had finally earned it. You ever been there? You know what you deserve. And doggone it, you didn't get it. I ran out of there, not announced, been overlooked yet again. I've been striving for that moment of my life since I was like 7 years old at that time. When the moment finally came and I was overlooked, I was rejected. I mean, come on, we can laugh about it now, but let me ask you this. What is that moment for you that seems so final in its moment? What is it that seems so just condemning, even though it really wasn't? Time has went on. You know, I can look back at so many moments of real disappointment in my life, whether it was a little league team, whether it was the most embarrassing moment, it says being the end of a crowd of people's jokes at the time, whether it was the time of, you know, that the girl broke up with me, and I was like, what are you doing, you know, and left heartbroken at some point, or whether it's the times where I felt like, you know, I wasn't able to provide as well as I would like to as a husband or as a dad, that there felt like there was gaps that I could not fill, and it bothered me, and I feel the weight of that, of being able to provide like that. Whatever it is, where were you? Let me ask you, where were you when the times it seemed like utter disappointment came, but yet you've lived past them? You've moved on. You went to the next step. I've realized the further down the road I've passed on from the disappointments, I've learned that really every disappointment I've ever had was actually a blessing, and I didn't know it. It wasn't a blessing to get rejected, but it was a blessing to prepare me for later in life to deal with people who feel rejected. It wasn't a blessing to feel like life is sometimes a struggle, but it's been a blessing to be able to get down in that valley with people in the midst of the struggle and say, you know what, God brings you out of the struggle. It's been a blessing to feel not qualified, to be able to minister with people who all feel unqualified, and to say, you know what, it's okay because God alone qualifies us. It's a position, it's a sonship and a daughtership. It's not a trophy. The disappointments have always been God's tools for shaping the heart for a greater plan of His. It's like that for all of us. Do you realize that every hurt is really just a tool that God is using to conform us, that we may be used for His glory in another situation later? It's not to break your heart. It's to break your heart in a way that you can get down with the brokenhearted and hurt with them in order to see the you know what, morning. We may mourn through the night, but we're going to see the joy of the Lord come in the morning. It always comes. It's clockwork. So many temporary moments seem to be the end of the world. Question, are there any temporary moments of your past that you're still holding the hurt today, though, and possibly missing the blessing that God wanted it to result in? Are there hurts you're holding today that should have been past, but because you're holding the hurt, you're missing the blessing of what God was given in the midst of it? You see, God planned you and I as part of an eternity plan, not a temporary plan, an eternity story. before we began our temporary existence. Many years ago, a man and a woman had a son. I don't know where they started out with this, but I know at some point this man and woman, they got married. At some point this man and woman, they had a son. They had no idea what their son would grow up to be. There was probably nights that they argued about who would change the diaper and who would get up and tend to him and what have you. Having no idea of a divine plan that God had on this man when he's in his late 40s or early 50s. I'm not sure which. And so as time goes on, this man goes up and he ends up working in a place that only God could have set these things up. And so he's working at a place and he has a customer come to his office. And he has a customer, a lady who is in her late 60s to early 70s. And this seems like just a normal conversation and another normal day. But he begins just to, out of just the overflow of who he is, he talks to her about Christ and asks her about her relationship. And they talk about everything else, and they complete their business transaction and out the door, and it was over and done. And it seemed like just another ordinary encounter for this 40-something-year-old man who his mom and dad dealt with him as a young child, having no idea that God had an eternal plan. And it wasn't just to give them a child. It was what God would do through their child. So it seemed like a normal conversation between this man and this woman, business owner and customer, until a couple days later some mail arrives. In the mail there's a letter, a personal letter written to him, and says, "I want to thank you so much for the other day." And says, "I have my suicide plan for the very next day. You are my last stop. My last place to go. For the next day, I would die. I was ready to end it all." And that conversation and the love I felt, I'm still here today. And the suicide note is torn up. I will not need it anymore. We never know, do we? We can get overwhelmed with the temporary, but God uses every temporary moment. True story, God uses every temporary moment. It's about fulfilling a final plan. Even the timing of that man's birth to get his education, to get in the place for a lady who would one day be on her last rope, who was many years older, for her life to continue on as God designed. Because she was missing the joy of his design up to that point. You see, God planned for you as a part of an eternity story. You see, we miss out on the good plan that God created us for when we make the temporary moments, even our temporary years, the big story of our lives, don't we? When God created us for a time in history to fulfill an important part of his eternally big story. For that lady, it was a difference in life and death. For that man, it was just a normal conversation that day. What if we woke up to see the dwelling? What if we did this, and we're going to transfer, and I'm going to tie all this together with a lot of scripture, but what if we woke up to see dwelling on temporary setbacks? That man could have, at any point, he could have got upset about other tragedies that have happened along the way in his life up to that point. He could have used the bad relationships. He could have used the children's stories. He could have used the hardship stories. He could have used anyone to not be in the place, to not have the conversation of Christ that he was having that day. But eternity hung in the balance for someone else. What if we woke up to see that dwelling on the temporary setback isn't the devil trying to get to you? You ever say that? "Well, I know I give my life to the Lord. Man, the devil, he's after me now. I mean, he's really working me over. I'm trying to live this life for the Lord. You know, I'm turning my life around, and he ain't happy about it. He's mad about it." What if we realize, though, something very important, that the devil is not really after you? But he's attempting to steal your attention from the God who works and saves lives through you. Can we just admit, I mean, we are to God, but in the big scope of things, we're not all that important. But we're incredibly valuable and important for what comes behind us as a result of the flow of God we allow to come through us. The compassion, the serving, the giving, the loving, the extending, the believing we allow to flow through us is incredibly valuable because it can go on for decades and generations. You have a Bible in your hand because of somebody you will never know centuries ago allowed it to flow through them and put it in the English language for you. Let's make this applicable. What is your worry or disappointment that you carry right now? What is the worry or the disappointment that you carry at this moment? What is it that has the power when it cycles back through your mind, it literally sucks the life back out of you? Do you have any of those? I'm not trying to dig or prod, but I wanted to kind of set up, because I believe that God wants us to say, you know what? Don't hide it. Let's conquer it and see Jesus move through it. What is it that just sucks the life? What is it that has the power to just knock the feet out when it cycles? We think we're past it, and then we see the person who reminds it. We hear the story reminds it. We see somebody else go through a similar story, and it reminds us, and it's like, we relive it again. Or sometimes we see them celebrate and where we had a loss. It's like it sucks the life out of us to see them celebrate what we wish we had. We don't see any way out of problem. It is for a reason. It is the reason that we are suffering. It is the matter that causes us to compare ourselves to someone else. Let me ask you this. Whatever it is, whatever that thing is that cycles, a very simple question. Do you still want it to control you a year from now or 5 years from now? Do we still want to be on the same bandwagon, the same roller coaster? Do we want it still in the life that God has given us? Still a year and 5 years from now. Do we want to steal in the life that God has to go through us? Because it will, until we begin to accept this, that our life is not predestined by our circumstance. Our life is predestined by our God. And if we will accept it, then we can live in the fulfillment of His plan that He wrote before we existed. I'll show you a story in 2 Kings 4. Watch this. In 2 Kings 4, we come across a wealthy family. Not just a wealthy, but a godly family. Her and her husband would cook. Her husband, she would get ready. He was wealthy. They'd go out, tend the fields. Everything was flowing. And they met this man of God named Elisha. They would do nice things. They would cook for him, and they would tend to him. And they would, every time he would come in town. But then they took it a step further. And this is what they did. They said, we're not just going to invite him into our house anymore. Here's what we're going to do. So it says, so she did as she was. Oh, that's not verse 9. I'm sorry. That's not verse 9 either. There you go. She said to her husband, I am sure this man who stops in from time to time is a holy man of God. Let's build a small room for him on the roof. And let's furnish it with a bed, a table, a chair, a lamp. Then he will have a place to stay whenever he comes by here. These people were wealthy, and they used their wealth to serve others. That's admirable. So with all this kindness, Elisha wanted to do something for her. If somebody builds a room on their house for you just to have a vacation spot, a stop-by spot, don't you think you like should do something for them? I mean, like, you know, a little payback here or something. Watch what happens. All the kindness, Elisha meets with this man named Gehazi. Gehazi is his servant. Gehazi is his second in command. Gehazi is the guy that says, that Elisha says, Gehazi, man, these people need to be healed, and they I can't get over there. Here, take my staff and go lay it on them. They'll be well. And Gehazi is an important guy. And so he talks with Gehazi, and he says this. He says, Elisha says to God, tell her, we appreciate the kind concern you have shown us. What can we do for you? Can we put in a good word for you with the king or the commander of the army? I mean, we got pull, we got connections. You want out of taxes, you want a new ride, you want to never have to renew your license, you know, whatever it may be. No, she replied, my family takes good care of me. I don't need all that stuff. It continues in verse 14. And so later, Elisha asks Gehazi, says, man, we got to do something. Got to do something. God replies, she doesn't have a son and her husband's old. He said, call her back in here. And Elisha told him, when the woman returned, Elisha said to her, she stood in the doorway. She has no idea what's coming. She looks, she says, next year you'll be holding a son in your arms. No! Well, man of God, don't deceive me. Translation, do not lie to me and get my hopes up like that. We're well taken care of, but there's always something in there, isn't it? The humanity side rises up. We can have everything the world has to offer, but yet always have a longing inside, unless and to the point we allow Christ to work through it. It says, no, don't lie to me like that. Don't get my hopes up like that. I bet you've been there. It's possible to get to a place that even our relationship with Jesus, we claim contentness. We claim that we have accepted some things just the way they are. Have you ever been there? It's like, well, you know, I just accept that's just the way it is for some people, and I'm that some people. And though we have accepted it, the truth is we're running from any moment that we're tempted to have hope again. Do you have any of those? I've just learned to accept the way that it is, but yet we run from any. I refuse to believe. I refuse to pray again. I refuse to trust God in that area again because I refuse to get hurt again. And though we have accepted because it seems easier to accept the pain than to risk releasing the pain, but had the fear of hopes failing, doesn't it? You ever been there? Today, perhaps, you aren't that one holding the disappointment of the temporary. Perhaps you say, Danny, I've moved on, man. I've just accepted it. You know, that's how we cope, isn't it? You know, I've just accepted it. We just accept it. But what if we just accepted the very things that God never wanted us to accept to begin with? Oh, how sad the tragedy would be that God has something that he said, you hang on, it's just not time yet. But yet we said, no, I learned to cope with it, and I just accept the failure, and I just accept the hurt. I accept the gap. And God the whole time said, I didn't create you to accept the gap. But you did have to wait a little bit longer. And we miss what we should have waited for by just accepting it. If it brings, here's a kicker. If it brings death to our spirit to accept it, then it's not the Spirit of God. If it brings life to our spirit even in the midst of accepting it, then it's the Spirit of God. Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is a river. The Holy Spirit is a river, and it runs, and it brings life into dead places. It flows through the city of God. It flows through the desert places, and it creates life wherever it goes. So if it brings death, it's not something that we're to accept. But if it brings life and peace to let go, then there's your dividing line. I'm thankful for those that have influenced me. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for those that have influenced me that did not just accept it in things. Thankful for people like, I'm thankful for things in the Word of God like Moses. We read him, we can't clock him off as our quiet time, but I'm so thankful that he didn't just say, you know what, I failed 40 years ago and I'm not ever going to try again. I'm thankful for people like Abraham in the Bible who stepped up and said, in Romans it says, against all hope he kept hoping. I'm thankful for people that just would not take surrender, though they should have surrendered so many times. I'm thankful for people today that continue to reach and continue to strive. I'm thankful for a God who has a son who said, you know what, I died, that's enough. But he said, you know what, I'm not going to lay down on this. I'll believe again that people can be saved and my life will matter, and Jesus rose from the dead. Some of you know what I'm talking about, because the only reason you're here today is you chose to accept that there is hope in Christ and there is His power and His love. One more time you just said, I'm going to go one more time. I'm going to strive one more time. I'm going to believe one more time. I'm going to let my hopes get up one more time. And as a result, it was fearful, but you chose to allow God to rise your hope up again. Have you been there? Remember the moment where he said, you know what, I'm just one more shot. You're like the lady going to the man, to the business saying, I'm giving just one more place to go. I'm giving just one more location. I'm giving one more conversation. I'm giving one more church attendance. I'm giving one more relationship a try. I'm opening my heart up just one more time. And it changed your life. And you give life today as a result. It was fearful, but you chose it. It's been the difference. You're now the result of it is you're still married where you wouldn't have been, or you're out of the bad relationship that you were going into. It's the only reason you have the child that you have, whatever it may be. And like Abraham in Romans 4:18, where it says, against all hope, he kept hoping and believed God and became the father of many nations. 2 Kings 4, the woman got the son in verse 17. But look what happens by verse 20. A year later, she has him. Verse 20, the boy's grown up enough to go out and work with dad, and he's out there one more, and he says, ah, my head hurts. And he says, look, take him to his mama. And goes in, and mama does what mama does, and she holds him and she rocks him until before noon he dies in her arms. Man, what a change happens from like verse 14, 15 just to verse 20. We call this a 30-minute, you know, quiet time. We read our chapter today, but this woman has had years of a journey wrapped up right here and hope that is gone. 13 years or so later, This boy has gotten a headache now one morning, and he dies by noon. The story continues. She gets her son. She does not weep. She stands up with him as she would when he fell asleep and carries him up to the room, but this time she does not carry him to his room. She carries him to the prophet's room, and she lays him on the prophet Elisha's bed, and she lays him right there. She comes back down. She goes out to her husband and says, "Husband, I'm going to town to find the prophet." He says, "It's not even Sunday. What are you doing?" And she says, it's going to be all right. I'll be back in a little while. Get the donkey ready. I need a ride. So he got the donkey ready. She heads into town. Watch what happens by verse 28. She finds Elisha. Then she said, "Did I ask you for a son, my Lord? And didn't I say, don't deceive me? And didn't I say, don't you dare get my hopes up?" When you just accepted the sorrow, that's the fear, isn't it? When that's why we just accept the sorrow and we accept the hurt and we just go on and we try to bottle and we try to contain and we try to close in, because the fear is, what if I do open my heart, and what if I do believe, and what if I do pray, and what if I do pray, and what if I do receive, but what if I do lose? I can't bear losing again. I can't bear having hope and losing hope. I would just rather not have hope. Verse 36. Then Elisha summoned Gehazi. He said, "Call the child's mother," he said. And when she came in, Elisha said, "Here, take your son." He went home with her. He lays on the boy, prays for the boy. He calls out to God for the boy. The boy arises. He wakes up. This is awesome. Back from the Hebrews 11 says, "And women receive back those that their loved ones from the dead." And she receives back. And that's a good end. But here's my thing. Elisha prays for the boy. He's back. As is normal, of the man in the house is still clueless that anything has happened. I mean, this is like so reality, right? He thought the kid was sick. So, I mean, the mama doesn't know the kid had died and raised again. Mama's gone to town where it took care of everything. Has no idea what mama has done. Comes back in and says, "Honey, what we got for supper?" And then the argument happens, but that's a whole other story. And that's a good end, but what, let me ask you this. I mean, I'll have to squeeze it in just a little story. What is really the point of this story? What is the point of God wrapping up 13 years of a journey? And actually beyond that, if you go back to what began her hurt, what is the point of God just putting this in here? I mean, really, what is the point of a lady going through all that experience? We read it, and yes, it's a good read. It fulfills our little quiet time checklist, and it's a good story. It's a good testimony. But really, I mean, this is God. What's the point? God could have just let the boy not die. You know, that would have been a good story. I mean, come on, why all the context in just a few verses for us to read today? Does the woman have to literally go through the barren years, to live the content years, to later face her fears, to receive what was impossible, only to live with fear again, then to express faith, and then to receive again? And we just had this long faith journey. Why does she have this story just for us to read today? That does not make sense to me. Until you turn over to 2 Kings chapter 8. It says, Elisha told the woman whose son he had brought back to life, "Take your family and move to some other place, for the Lord has called a famine on Israel that will last for 7 years." And there's a lot that happens in those few chapters. So she moves, but the famine ends, and she returns 7 years later. She walks into the king's palace. I love the boldness of this woman. She doesn't even go to her home and find trouble and then try to go and find help. She just walks up. Where is the king at? I mean, this is a woman who, she's just living life with bull by the horns the whole time, you know. She walks in the king's palace. She comes in town, walks up to the king, and she walks in, and verse 5 happens. Gehazi has leprosy at this point. Him and Elisha have split deals. Elisha said, "You're a crook, man. You're full of greed." And he had leprosy for the rest of his life. But he gets to talk. And it says, "And Gehazi was telling the king about the time Elisha had brought a boy back to life. At that very moment, the mother of the boy walked in to make her appeal to the king of the house of the land. 'Look, my lord, the king,' Gehazi exclaimed, 'here is the woman now, and this is her son. This is the boy I am telling you about right here. He's coming in,' and she walks in. There's no longer a husband in the picture. We don't know what happened to him. It may have been, you know, his not paying attention enough back in the day, but there is no longer a husband mentioned. We don't know their backstory of what happened to him, but we know a woman who could have lost everything. Because, I mean, women were second rate at that time. Women were left behind at that time. Women weren't allowed the privileges at that time. But we have a woman who could have lost everything. She walks into town, and not only does she go to her house, when she shows up at her house, the king's soldiers show up at her house. And when they walk into her house, and they tell whoever is there because somebody has taken over and occupied the land. And they say, you know what? Get out. You get out of this lady's house, and not only do you get out, all that money on the table that y'all been making all these years, you leave it because it belongs to her. The king says, whatever has been made profit over these last 7 years, you make sure she has everything. This woman leaves and never loses a thing and actually gains in the midst of what would have been suffering for most people. 7 years later, the birth of a son. Check this out. When you look at it like this, really, the birth of a son? The birth of a son was only a setup for what would appear in the moment of his death to be a tragedy. But the tragedy was to create a testimony that would provide greater for her later. That would provide greater for her later. The temporary is not the end, my friend. Whatever your temporary worry is, it isn't the end. It is just a portion of a God story to provide life even greater later. We started this series saying, everything now is a setup for later. Everything now is a setup for later. That was what we had. Everything now is a setup for later. But really, when you look at the bigger story and you look at how God works through so many people and the stories that he chose to pass down to you and I, it goes even further than everything now is a setup for later. Everything now, even every suffering moment, every portion that we encounter in life is only a place for God to provide life even greater later. It's not just a setup for later. It's a setup for greater for later. A setup for greater for later. A setup for greater for later. I wonder if you'd say it with me. A setup for greater later. The big story is that every moment, every life-shattering, every life-changing moment is a part of God's big story that will be revealed later. My last slide of the day. It says, God has you in a position. This is the bigger story of all of our lives. The bigger story is whatever place you're in right now, whatever moment we're going through right now, whatever season you're in right now, whatever setback you may be encountering right now, whatever struggle you may have, whatever tears you have cried over right now, you know, the bigger story in every single thing you've ever been through is that God has you in a position to work through you. God put her in a position to allow her son to die, to be rose again, so that a king would know there is a God in Israel. It wasn't just to give her son back in her own faith journey. It was a story where when she walked back into town, the whole town knew what God had done, and God received the glory again. Imagine if we allowed our life to be so wide open, that instead of saying, why is this happening to me? Say, okay, God, how are you wanting to use this story through me? How are you wanting to use this story through me? When you come to that place in life, the fulfillment has no end. With heads bowed and eyes closed, I ask you today, right where you are, perhaps you've been through a lot of things you just don't get, you don't understand. Perhaps you feel like you've suffered needlessly so many times. But perhaps God is even opening your idea, opening your mind, opening your heart to see, you know what? There is still within you a seed of hope. But if you'll allow it, you can hope again, and you can see God's restoration again. Everything lays on his miracle power. I want to ask you if that's you today. Possibly for you, you feel like you've drifted too far. You've gone too far away from God. He doesn't want you back. I just want to ask you right now, but you know what? Have hope again. He desires to be your father, and he desires to be your father that restores everything that has been lost in the meantime. He desires to restore to you abundantly, as we looked at Job last week, as we look at the prodigal son in the New Testament, as we look at the Shunammite woman in 2 Kings, that He desires to restore to you abundantly everything that has been lost, taken, or stolen. And I would just encourage you today to pray again and say, God, I trust You again. And God, I lay myself wide open to believe in You again. And Jesus, today I'm praying for the things I gave up on again. Believe in the miracles You can do in me and through me. For some, that's a prayer of salvation, to say, Lord Jesus, I trust today You're receiving me as a son and daughter. I desire to be saved today. I'm going to ask you to stand as the band plays and as they close us down. However God moves on you, let's respond. We're just going to have a couple of moments here. So I'm going to say respond quickly. I'd love to pray with you. Love to walk this journey with you. Love to see what God is doing through you, that it may continue. This is a new day, just as the day where the woman stood for the doorway and said, don't you get my hopes up again. But everything she'd always hoped for came back. Let this be today, that everything that was hoped for according to God's plan, everything that was by His power, that is for His good, His glory, His blessing, His power working through you. He is a God who even desires to give good things. May this be the day that we stand in the doorway and say, Lord, my hopes are back up. I don't dare You to not give me hope. Lord, my hopes are back up, and I am trusting You and walking this path that Your story is revealed through me to save other people and to see people redeemed in Jesus' name. Let this be the day that we rise up again in Jesus' name.